Well, good afternoon, friends. My name is Amar. Welcome to the webinar today on pathologists at work. That's a new word for many of us. Traps, of course, we know, but we never knew what is pathologist. So it's an honor and a privilege to have all of you on this Wednesday afternoon. The webinar is going to be approximately for 60 minutes. And today I am also supported and guided by my senior colleague, George Christopher, who is the master trainer also for many programs other than pathologist at work. And we would like to give all of you a warm welcome. So the couple of things which I would like to set in terms of setting the stage is please feel free to unmute yourself and ask me and George questions when we kind of go on with the webinar. You can also kind of type and do text messages on the chat box. I have my team here who can synthesize your messages, your feedback, or your questions, and they can ask me and George about it. So you're more than welcome to do it. I always believe that the webinars should not be a one-sided affair. It should be a two-sided affair. So please, let's kind of try and make it interactive and not just PowerPoint. The webinar is comprising of PowerPoint slides, and of course I have videos, and occasionally I'll be kind of pausing to see if I'm getting any reactions, any suggestions. I hope that works fine for all of us. So can I start? Can I have a thumbs up from all of you? Great. So let me start by kind of giving you an introduction as to who we are. About my company, we are BYLD Group, that is Building Your Leadership Differentiators. We are the largest aggregator of HR services in this part of the hemisphere, that is South Asia region. We are right into strategic HR, and you have many things which we do in terms of initiatives, in terms of strategic HR. Operational HR, we also work with 50% of Fortune 500 companies here in India and South Asia, and 60% of our business is also coming from top 1,000 companies as far as the Indian conglomerates and Indian companies are concerned. And that's how we are kind of positioned. We firmly believe in our core values, which is care, customer centricity, accountability, reciprocity, and entrepreneurship. So that's about our group in terms of introduction as to who we are. You name it and we have it in terms of HR practices, learning and development initiatives and imperatives, which is important for individuals, teams, and organizations. Also, we are very proud to say that we are associated with top global brands when it comes to training solutions. We are authorized partners for Everything Desk Wiley, which is a company from the US. Also with Vital Smarts, again a company from the US, Blanchard, which you must have heard of, Ken Blanchard Group of Companies, Five Behaviors, famous book, Luminous Spark, Persona Global, and also we are very proud to say that we have a sister concern, Yoma, which is into HR solutioning and technology, and of course DTCI, which is again a sister concern of ours, which is Door Training and Consulting. So we have different brands under the larger umbrella of BYLD. Today, the webinar is all about pathologists at work. So, so how many of you have heard the word pathology? Anyone, you can unmute, you can talk, or even you can type in the chat box. Anyone have heard the word pathology? Okay. Anubhuti, let me know the responses if something is coming in the chat box.
So Amar, Parag and Karishma have mentioned that they have not heard about it before.
Okay, great. I'm sure all of us have definitely heard about the word trap. And trapology is more of a subject in terms of handling traps. Now, this is a famous picture of Stephen Covey. Stephen Covey is one of the most famous management gurus and the best-selling book's author, that is Seven Habits of Highly Effective People. And his son, that is David Covey, has written this book, which I'll be showing you in a moment's time from this, after this slide, on seven traps. And this book was written in the year 2017. But before we go on and go on to the next slide, what does Covey say? live life in a crescendo. Your greatest work is always ahead of you. Crescendo means the top, the pinnacle of, you know, of your life. So you always kind of live there and think about the greatest work or the greatest challenge or your passion which you have, which is ahead of you. That's what Dr. Covey used to say. Now his son, of course, this is again the picture of Stephen Covey, that is Seven Habits of Highly Effective People, one of the best-selling books. We all have kind of read it. We have gone through the training. We have heard so much about it. So many people have implemented. And that's the legacy Dr. Stephen Covey leaves for all of us. And the legacy continues today in form of David Covey. That's his son. And he wrote the book along with his fellow colleague, Stefan, Strap Tales, that is Outsmarting the Seven Hidden Obstacles to Success. This book was highly researched. And then it was written in the year 2017. And then on, they kind of converted this book into a training program, helping individuals to be more effective at workplace. So far, so good. Okay, moving on. What happens is, invariably, the challenges which we face in workplace is that, you know, we fall into traps. And the best example which comes to my mind is, if you were playing chess as a kid or even now as an adult, you know, when you're playing against the competition or opponent, you know, you are kind of always planning a trap to kind of get him into the trap so that you can win the game. And similar are the challenges when it comes to our workplace, that, you know, unwittingly how we fall into those traps without even realizing what those traps could be. So this webinar is all about identifying those traps and how we can overcome those traps to become more productive, to become more confident, to kind of be very effective. So this is also kind of talking to you in terms of how can you improve your personal effectiveness at workplace, right? So as you see, this lady, you know, absolutely dressed in a business suit, going to work, on a thin rope, and you see all the traps below her. So that's an analogy or a dramatization of the picture, which tells you that we are unaware of these traps. What if she falls off and, you know, she kind of gets into one of these traps? What will happen to her? A productivity and the other things start kind of falling down. So that's the logic in terms of this particular picture. What we do in terms of restraining forces and driving forces. We come to workplace with a lot of enthusiasm, with a lot of passion, and we want to do a lot of good things. So, you know, we have the driving forces which is pushing us forward. It is taking us forward. But at the same time, there are also restraining forces which kind of pushes you back. And that's where the struggle and the resistance starts. And that's the kind of current situation many of us today are facing. Even more so, why I say that is because in the given circumstances of COVID, you know, it has become very, very uncertain. We all are living in a very, very dynamic world, in a very volatile world, what we call VUCA world, which is volatile, uncertain, you know, ambiguous, complex. We are working from home. So there's so many traps which we may not be aware. And this is a kind of an awakening and kind of a realization as to how we can identify those traps and what can we do about it. Moving on. Any questions, please unmute yourself, or you can even put, you know, your reactions and feedback or questions in the chat box. I'll keep repeating that. Also, before I move on, is my voice okay? Is my audio, my video okay? Anubhuti, can you confirm that?
Yes, Samar, all good.
All good, great. My speed, yes, sir, good. Fine. Vaibhav, all good. Thank you for that.
Yes, sir.
Yes. Now, when we talk about traps, it's just like you driving your car. And what we say here is that, you know, you are accelerating and you want to go at the top speed to reach your destination fast. But at the same time, while you're pushing your feet on the pedal of the accelerator, at the same time, you're also pushing hard on the brakes. So how are you going to gain momentum or velocity? It's just not possible. It's just not possible. And those are the booby traps we kind of, you know, fall into and we are unaware of. So what are we trying to say here? What are the insights or the main objectives of this particular training program? Is that to enact positive changes, there must be increased focus on removing the restraining forces. Those are the traps versus adding another driving force. So we are talking about the traps and we are talking about also what to do to come out of that trap. So that is the driving force here. To avoid the seven traps, we have to execute new and revolutionary idea. The old school of thoughts, the conventional approach is not going to be applicable in this era, in this world, because everything is going towards the digitalization. It is going towards, you know, virtual platforms. We all are sitting at home doing meetings through Zoom calls. We always are now kind of, also there's something on a Zoom fatigue, which kind of comes in because we have so many meetings which are virtual on virtual platforms. So we need to be mindful of all these things. So these are things which needs to be kind of thought about when it comes to an individual. Who is a trapologist? That's a good definition, right? What do you mean by a trapologist? Some of my friends there in the chat said that we don't know what is trapology or trapologist is all about. Well, a trapologist is a person who detects and avoids the seven traps. So are you interested in becoming a trapologist? If you feel that it is right, then say yes in the chat box or unmute yourself and you can say yes. Do you want to know more about trapology? Do you want to become a trapologist? Parag says yes. Paushali says yes. I get two yeses. Manoj, okay. Good. So let's continue with the webinar. That's the sequencing as far as trapologist is concerned. There are seven traps which is identified by doing high amount of research, which, you know, as I said, was kind of published in a book way back in the year 2017, and that's now translated into a training program. What are those seven traps? Now, so the seven traps is kind of divided in three different compartments or divisions. It always starts with you first. The three traps, as far as I, me, myself, or you are concerned, is the trap of busyness. I'm always busy. I don't have time. The trap of procrastination. Can I do that later? Is it okay if I do it tomorrow? The third trap, which is also equally dangerous, is ego. Long back, when I was working in Malaysia, I had an Australian boss, and he gave me a fantastic definition of ego. He said, Amar, do you know what is the full form of ego? I said, no, I don't know, but I definitely know what is the meaning of ego. He said, ego means edge God out. You know, that's how you need to kind of look at. So ego becomes a big trap when it comes to an individual. And then we go to the team. When we talk about team, it is we, all of us together, like my team or our team together. What are the traps as far as teams are concerned? You know, the first trap is silo mentality. I care about my team, I care about my work, I care about my team's results, but I don't care about my other team members or other teams in terms of their results and how do we collaborate and what do we need to do. So typical of a silo mentality. The word silo actually is used in technical terms when we are into, you know, cement manufacturing, where they have huge silos full of limestone and bauxite. So that's picked up from there. It's a silo mentality. We are inside that silo and we don't want to budge. So that's one. The fourth one is triggered, then it is silo. So, you know, what is the trigger which we have? How do we kind of get triggered or irritated and, you know, kind of lose our temper or our patience or lose our cool? What are the possible triggers I may have in the team? And the sixth one is settling. Finally, when you're talking about you, we are talking now about us, which is the organization, by and large, the entire organization. There can be myopia in the organization. Today's discussion, since it is just about a brief 45 to 50 minutes of webinar, we are going to restrict our discussions. Just a minute, let me annotate. Anubhuti, confirm red dot.
Yes, Amar, we are able to see.
Yeah, we are going to restrict our discussions in terms of you and discuss about three traps right now. The rest of the things we kind of cover in the workshop which we organize. These public workshops, we can also do in-house program for your organizations, for your teams, is basically anywhere between a four-hour format and a six-hour format. So we can do it for 3 hours in the morning, then we can take a lunch break and we come back in the training room that is on the virtual platform, of course, and we do it for 3 hours. And there we cover all the 7 traps in detail, talking about the traps and also possibly giving you the kind of solutions and suggestions that how can you be mindful of this and how can you come out of it. Any questions, any points? I'll take a pause for about 5-6 seconds.
Amar, yes? Comes last, what is myopia?
Yeah, please go ahead, George.
No, no, someone has asked in the chat box, what is myopia?
Yeah, go ahead.
Short-sightedness. I can't see far. I can see only things which are close to me. So some companies don't even think about far-reaching consequences or plans for about 5 years or 10 years. They just think about today, 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 and every one day they move on. Those companies will never work. Even certain teams have got myopia. Some people have got myopia, physically as well as in the work. It'll never work. I always say that you should have a 3-year, 7-year, 10-year plan for your life. If you don't have that, you have to keep on revising it, which means you have myopia. That's what we call it as myopia.
Yeah. The word myopia comes from medical sciences. When you go to an eye specialist and he says you have myopia, you have short-sightedness. And that's exactly what my colleague George is trying to say, that you're not able to see a bit beyond, you know, you're not able to see beyond the obvious, which you need to plan and factor in if you want to be very successful as an organization. And that also kind of cascades down to the teams and also to the individuals. That's what. So any questions about this particular chart? Because this is the mainframe as far as the program is concerned, that we will be talking about these 7 traps in detail, picking up each trap at a time. As I said, since this is a webinar, we are restricting this to the first 3 traps, which is, you know, busyness, procrastination, and ego. Okay, how does this work? Now, what we do here principally is, you know, that the process is that first of all, we need to recognize what are the possible traps, right? And the second thing which we need to do in the process is we need to quantify the traps, as to we need to measure those traps. You know what, that's the reason why you have this compass kind of a thing here, which is kind of reflecting, which shows here. You see this? And then
that's the caliper.
That's the caliber, the compass.
That's the caliper that measures.
Yeah, which you used to have in the geometry box when you used to go to the schools, you know. Then the third step is that we need to break away from the conventional approach, because the core philosophy of this particular program is that we need to break away from the conventional approach, which we one may have. We need to change that habit. And that's the reason why you have a hammer. So you need to break it. And the fourth is epiphany, a breakthrough, which is a bulb here where you get that realization. You know, that realization is the most important. And how can you have epiphany breakthroughs when you break away from conventional approaches is what is the ultimate point as far as the process of prepologist is. I hope I'm making sense and making good use of your time. Please let me know if there's any question, and is it adding meaning to your time here? If yes, please register yes in the chat box. Meanwhile, at the same time, I have also requested my colleagues to share the brochure of 7 traps with all of you, and you can download it from the chat box, and you can kind of read it whenever you're free, and you can also touch base with us if you want more information. I can even come to your organization, webinar, of course. I can do a webinar for all of you. And we also have public workshops. We have in-house programs. As I said, that we do the complete program. Now, the trapology sequence, as I said, we're going to talk about these 3. We're moving on very quickly. The first trap is the busyness trap. And it says the drowning in the thick of thin things. So you are, you know, when we ask each other, when we pick up the phone and we talk to friends or colleagues, they say, how is your day? Oh man, don't tell me, I'm super busy. Since morning, I'm in back-to-back meetings. You know, I say, okay, so how has it been going? I have no time to even breathe, man. I have been so busy. So that's the first and foremost trap which we need to identify. So trap number one the busyness trap. How do we recognize these traps? We don't filter what is coming to us, which means we are doing everything randomly without organized or planned approach and just doing it for the sake of it is as it is coming to. So we don't have any mechanism as far as filtration is concerned. We fail to identify things that deserve our focus. You know, now, what do you mean by that? We fail to identify the things that deserve our focus. You know, I have seen many few people who are very organized and methodical when it comes to emails and the time spent on emails on daily basis. Some people have clear time from 9:30 to 10:30, I'll do mail. Then I will do my project work. Then I'll do something else. Then from 12:30 to 1 o'clock before lunch, I'll again go back to my emails and check my emails and reply to that. So those are the things which we kind of fail to recognize and organize ourselves when it comes to the track of busyness. And of course, you know, we say yes to many things. Now, this is also a cultural issue, you know, because if my boss or my senior or my, you know, a senior colleague of mine, you know, kind of says, can you do this for me? Can you do this project? Can you head this project? Can you handle this? We don't have to say yes to everything. Sometimes we have to say no. But how to say no is also an art, which we kind of cover in the course and we talk about it, you know, in the course in length. So we say yes to too many things. Any questions, any reactions, Anubhuti, Himani?
No, Amar.
All right.
We are good to go as of now.
Okay. So these are some of the, you know, statements made by renowned scholars across the world, you know, British economist John, he kind of made the statement, you know, which futurist predicted on our current world correctly. He says, for the first time since his creation, man will be faced with his real permanent problem. For the first time since his creation, man will be faced with his real permanent problem, how to use his freedom from pressing economic cares, how to occupy leisure, which science and compound interest will have won for him to live wisely and agreeably and well. So he was able to see the future somewhere in the year 1940s, you know, and or maybe 1930s or 1920s, and he could predict what is coming up as far as our current world is concerned. Some more. I'm not going to spend too much of time on this because we can cover many other things. You know, Jeffrey once made a statement, again, a famous British scientist. Rather than being bored to death, our actual challenge is to avoid anxiety attacks and strokes resulting from being accelerated to death. Yeah. So what does that mean? In terms of busyness, we're still on the trap of busyness, right? So in terms of busyness, way back in the 70s, when we used to have the landline and one black telephone, and many of course, there are a lot of youngsters who were not even born at that era. You know, we used to have about 1,000 calls a year. And as we kept on moving decades after decades, the number of interactions per year went on. You know, in the 80s, we have 4,000 interactions. And then in the 90s, we had the emails coming in. You know, it started off with Hotmail, if you remember. And then it went on to Yahoo and then Google and so on and so forth. We used to have 9,000 interactions. In the 2000s, we have 20,000 interactions or more per day, per week, per year, sorry. And now it's madness. It is chaotic out there, at least for me. You have so much of social media all around you. While people are discussing and having meetings, your WhatsApp is ringing, you are on Instagram, you are on Twitter, you are on Facebook, you are on some chat, you are doing this, you are doing that, emailing. So that's the reality as far as we are concerned. And we cannot shy away from this. This is the reality we all are living in. So that's the number of interactions where you have stopped count as to how many interactions you have. Having said that, research says that work is 50% of non-essential interactions which we have. 50% of non-essential interactions. So say, for example, if you're putting 8 hours a day in terms of your work, 4 hours more or less is for non-essential interactions, which is having very low value. okay, keeping time in mind, I'm going to be a bit fast. There are too many distractions and too many disruptions and distractions in this COVID time. Just a minute, please. I am just having a little bit of a technical glitch. Yeah. So statistics say that 54% of employees have more distractions at home. 40% of employees find it hard to focus on work at home because there's so much of disturbance, distractions, dhobi coming, milkman coming, knocking on the door, doorbells ringing, something or the other, and you need to keep getting up and going and seeing what's going on. 15% of the employees find it hard to focus on work with everything going on in the world. Things are not good right now in India. We know the kind of challenges we are facing. It is scary. People are afraid. They don't know how to react. So these are all the realities which we are facing. Nothing is kind of an illusion which we are talking here about today in the webinar. It is the fact. All of us are in home. We are scared to step out. So these are the disruptions as far as COVID is concerned. I'd like to now make it, you know, very interesting. I would like to play a video which was very famous. It went viral. This video was not from the COVID time, but this video is applicable in this COVID time. Watch this video and I'll come back to you.
Scandals happen all the time. The question is, how do democracies respond to those scandals?
And what will it mean for the wider region? I think one of your children has just walked in. I mean, shifting sands in the region. Do you think relations with the North may change?
I would be surprised if they do. My apologies.
What is this going to mean for the region?
My apologies. South Korea's policy choices on North Korea have been severely limited in the last 6 months to a year.
So, did you see the video? Any experiences? Does anyone have this kind of experience at home? You can unmute or you can put your reactions in the chat box. Anyone?
Yes, Amar, we do have the reaction. Sunil says, yes, a lot of time he has experienced this.
Yeah. In fact, you know, when your cameras are on, your videos are on, sometimes your better half, your spouse or your daughter, you know, they come and the first thing they ask is your camera on? Are you on mute? And then they want to say something. And then you need to turn back and say, what is it? Can't you see I'm doing a webinar? I'm in an important meeting with a client. What's wrong with you? So these are the possible distractions we may have. And that leads to busyness, which again, as I said, 50% is non-essential. So moving on, what is the conventional approach which we always think of? You know, you need to juggle the balls better. Amar was juggling 3 balls at one point in time. Now he's juggling 4 balls. Now when George sees that Amar is able to juggle 4 balls, he says, Amar, hey, you're doing well. Here is the 5th ball. Here is the 6th ball. And Amar wants to become a better juggler. Is Amar a juggler in the circus? No, for God's sake. But our conventional thinking, when it comes to busyness, is what, oh, I need to do things better. I need to plan better. I need to organize myself better. No, but you are actually becoming a juggler because you're taking too many things head on and you're saying yes to too many things. So what is the breakthrough moment here when it comes? You know, become a better juggler. Do you want to be a better juggler? I don't think so. You want to be more effective at workplace. So what is the thing which you need to do in terms of epiphany breakthrough? Say no to non-essential things and narrow your focus to top priorities. When me and George were doing one of these webinars previously, you know, one of the participants asked, Amar, how can I say no to my boss if he's giving me a project? And well, that's a challenging question. I mean, that's a very sharp question. The answer is, you know, you need to write down the amount of work and the projects you are doing. And you say, okay, boss, I'm ready to take on this project. can I cut off one of these projects and add this into the list? Your boss will then perhaps realize that you already have too much and he may give this project to someone else. So these are certain things which we kind of go through in the training program as to how you handle all these things. Say no to non-essential things and narrow your focus to top priorities. That is the breakthrough when it comes to busyness. Now, this is a logo everyone knows. I'm so sure of it. The logo of Apple. Now, Apple, you know, was going through a lot of product innovation. A lot of things were happening. And our friend, you know, Steve Jobs, when he took over, he kind of read the situation. And, you know, we all know that he was a genius and he was perhaps, you know, a techie with a super mind. He came up with a simple concept. He said, stop all the projects which you have. And he said, let's just focus on four products. So he came up with 2x2 matrix. He came up with desktops for consumers and professionals, and then portables, which is iBook and PowerBooks. That's it. He said, all the other products and the innovation, throw it into the dustbin. We will just focus on this four. The minimal, the better. That was the approach Apple had. And we know that, you know, what is the turnaround and how Apple is one of the most valuable companies in the world. Today, of course, Steve Jobs is no more with us. And we have Tim Cook, who is the current CEO of Apple, that he says that we are the most focused company I have known or ever read. You know, we say no to good ideas every day. We say no to good ideas every day. We say, you know, in order to keep the amount of things, we focus on very small numbers so that we can put enormous energy and focus. You know, that's one thing. Of course, we know this. I'm not going into here. When it comes to some three examples in terms of taking action, set email times for email, maybe 4 times a day, morning, afternoon, then late afternoon, and then evenings before you retire and say bye to your laptop. Do projects and strategic work in the morning because you're fresh, you are full, because you had slept well, you had the best of the breakfast. So you're with all the rigor and the energy which one needs. So all the important works can be done in the first half and the rest. So that's the way you plan your day. And the third is, you know, constantly or consistently kind of, you know, review top three project priorities each week as to what are your top three work priorities. You'll be able to kind of come up with good habits in terms of busyness. So far, so good. We are almost about 3:40 and 20 minutes to go. So I'm slightly going to move forward and fast. The second trap is procrastination trap. And, you know, this caterpillar, basically, we are trying to say is that this caterpillar more or less, finally, you know, that the caterpillar converts or turns into a butterfly and starts flying. But this caterpillar, for some reason, is not wanting to move out from this particular branch or this wood piece. It wants to stay there. So that's the definition of procrastination. Procrastination is not doing things immediately then and then and keeping on postponing things, you know, and idling in status quo. That's the definition of procrastination. So what are the how do we recognize these traps? We lack discipline that requires change. We find the change to be difficult, painful, and uncomfortable. We also have humiliation. And when it comes to failure, what if I fail? You know, I feel very humiliated. I feel very insulted. Oh my God, how am I going to handle failure? So these are certain things. That's why we don't want to move and we kind of stay in the limbo and we stay in the status quo. And that creates the trap of procrastination. Again, the conventional approach which one may have is delay until circumstances force change. And they rely on willpower to sustain change. You know, what does that mean? Like, you know, let's not go here. Now, what happens is, say, for example, a person is a chain smoker, you know, and he used to smoke 40 cigarettes a day or 20 cigarettes a day. When his doctor says that, hey, if you don't stop smoking, you're going to die. That is the time the person may perhaps stop smoking. Other thing which he may do to stop smoking is when his spouse or his daughter or his son walks up to him, he says, you know, if you're not going to kind of stop, you know, we are going to walk away from you. I'm going to break the relationship with you. I'm going to divorce you. That is the time, you know, he may perhaps change that habit. Or, you know, sometimes what happens is because of this bad habit, you know, there is a delay in upgrading myself. I was not very good with computers, maybe, or I did not know something about the new technology. And that's the reason the company is planning to look at me and ask me to leave, because I don't have those skills. I'm not able to be flexible in adapting. These are the conventional stands. That time I suddenly kind of realized and I said, oh my God, I better do a small term course or I do a short term course. That's not going to work anymore, because that's a conventional old school approach which we have. And as you see, that we need to break this habit or the approach as far as conventional style is concerned. What is the breakthrough moment? Breakthrough moment or epiphany moment means, you know, you have the self-realization. And what I have heard and I've read and I've discussed many a times with many people when we do these programs is, you know, the breakthrough moments or self-realization moments, you know, come in when you are in the bathroom. Yeah, in your shower. That time you think, oh my God, maybe I could have done that and that will work for me. So those are those moments which is known as the breakthrough moment. And what does it say as far as procrastination is concerned here is reinvent yourself before external forces require you to change. So be mindful as to what is coming. I'm not going into this video. But there are some books suggested in terms of procrastination and how we can change. Is change anything? Again, a book from one of our brands, which we kind of manage here in India, Change Anything, which is from Vital Smarts and of course, Good Habits by Wendy Woods. You know, what is the action you can take in terms of trapology, in terms of procrastination? Become more tech savvy. A lot of friends of mine, you know, at our age, you know, we have now started doing Google digital courses, which is available online, which is free of cost. A lot of people are kind of enrolling in Udemy and many other short-term courses. They're going into these kind of programs in terms of personal effectiveness, trapologist at work, understanding what it means to become, you know, more effective and more, and how can I be more successful in this kind of dynamic and fluid virtual world. Learn one skill a year, read one book a week. Now people say, Amar, I don't have the habit of reading books. No problems. You can subscribe to Audible. There are many audiobooks available on the apps now. You just have to switch it on and just listen to it whenever you're free, you're taking a walk or you're doing exercise or going up and down your building or whatever. So there are many ways, means and ways of kind of doing all these things, which is right in front of your screen. Pause for a second or two. Any questions you have? And how is it going for you guys? Any reactions, Anu?
Yes, Amar. They're saying it is going good.
Who's saying? I mean, who?
Sunil has mentioned, Ashish has mentioned that it is going good.
All right.
Sham Sundar has also mentioned it's going good.
Ah, yeah. Good evening. Good afternoon, Mr. Sham. Nice to see you here. Okay. So the trap number three, as I said, we're covering about you, me, that's I, me, myself, the trap of ego. And I am perfect. Nothing is wrong with me. You know, the whole world is wrong. I am right. That's the way I am. The ego in me. How do we handle this? Ah, that's a $1 million question. Now, what are the traps as far as ego is concerned? We don't want to risk looking bad. We don't want to step outside our comfort zone. We fear judgments. People will be judgmental about me. And fear of rejection. What if I say something and I sound like a stupid or an idiot in front of so many people? Oh my God, these are all signals of you having a bloated and a high ego. I having an ego. And the individual has to make those realizations on their own. So again, conventional approach, which used to work maybe a decade ago, perhaps, you know, our fathers and all, our grandfathers, limit yourself to activities within your which is within your comfort zone, where success is virtually guaranteed. So I create the comfort zone around me and I try to do things which is easy and comfortable for me. Anything which is a bit of a stretch for me, no go. Why? Because I may fail. I have fear of rejection. I have fear that people may judge me, and that is my ego which is stopping. And being egoistic also kind of boils down to being stubborn and adamant. This morning I had a chat with my son, and you know, he was telling me the same thing. He says, "Dad, you know what? You're very adamant by nature." I said, "Okay, I'm doing this webinar today." So in a way, you're saying that you have a good amount of ego. You need to do something about it. So that's the conventional approach where you don't want to get out of comfort zone. Now, you know, what are we doing in conventional approach? Only take assignments which you know well. You don't try to take a new role that requires new skills. And only commit to jobs you have done before. So this is the conventional approach, the comfort zone approach. You know, just give me the same thing which I've been doing 15 years ago. I'll do the same thing now. Don't give me something new. I'll not be able to kind of. Why? Because my ego stops me from doing it, as I don't want to take a risk. Again, an epiphany breakthrough. What does it say? Try, fail, learn, repeat. And have successful failures. You know, in the year 2019, I had gone to attend a conference in the US. And I was especially inspirational. I saw an inspirational speech by this lady who was into ice skiing. And she was on the stage talking about failures. And she said, you know, one thing which is important in failure is that fail, no problem. It's okay to fail. But how fast are you able to recover from that failure is the question. Now, she was participating in the championship for ice skating. She fell and her opponent also fell. Both of them fell at the same time. However, her opponent got up and recovered faster than this lady. So she got the number one position and this lady got the third position. So she says, you know, that is the moment that, you know, the faster you are in terms of adapting to failure and rising up to the occasions as quickly as possible, you know, that's what matters. And that's the epiphany breakthrough, where you have that self-realization that it's okay to fail. Thomas Alva Edison, Jeff Bezos, they say we kind of have this culture in our company as far as Amazon is concerned, that failure is part of our culture. It's okay to fail. It's okay to experiment. And so many of us fear, when it comes to failures. Though I'm mindful of the time, we still have about good 14 minutes. I want to show you a good video. You know, recently, Dyson vacuum cleaners have been launched in India. Do people know about it? Can I have some reactions? Yes, it's one of the best vacuum cleaners in the world today. It's expensive. But now, since the maids and all those people are not coming, a lot of families who can, you know, perhaps buy this, have bought this, invested in this, and it's fantastic. It gets rid of a lot of dirt. This is the video of the company's CEO, and listen to him what he's trying to say. So I'll play this video and then I'll stop the presentation. Then we can have a little bit of a Q&A, question and answer. I can answer, and even George, my colleague here, can also answer. Any questions, any reactions in the chat box before I go to the video?
No, everybody has just mentioned that, yes, they have heard about the Dyson. And yeah. It is very good.
Yeah. So listen to the CEO. What is he talking and what is he saying about failure?
There's a myth about inventors that all you need is one good idea and you'll make.
Oh, sorry. Anu, is the video's audio coming through?
Yes, it is. It was coming.
There's a myth about inventors that all you need is one good idea and you'll make your fortune. But the fact of the matter is, you don't have ideas like that. Well, you start with a problem that you're having to solve, and you start building prototypes, hundreds of them, perhaps even thousands of them. And very often, the original idea or the original problem doesn't look anything like the final solution. So the important thing is this journey from prototype to prototype. And during that process, of course, you get hundreds or thousands of failures. And the failure is the starting point, because when something fails, you understand why it fails, and then you start to think of ideas as to ways you can overcome that failure. I mean, the cyclones for my vacuum cleaner took over 5,000 prototypes. That's 5,000 failures before I'd cracked it. So the moral of the tale is keep on failing. It works.
Inspirational video, right? Inspirational. Any comments? The moral of the story is keep failing. And that's how we got the invention as far as bulbs are concerned, Thomas Alva Edison, you know, and then so on and so forth. of course, when it comes to egos and seeing what best, there are some recommendations as far as these books are concerned. These are one of the most the top selling products or books in the world today. I have read one of them. I have read The Outliers by Malcolm Gladwell. Of course, the rest of the two I haven't read, but I would love to read them whenever I have the time and the patience to do that. So these are some of the books. So in the training program, we do recommend a lot of things. We kind of have people in different breakout rooms. They brainstorm about each, traps. They come together. They kind of decide what needs to be done and so on and so forth. So it's a very interactive training program, which we kind of have designed for this particular thing. So when it comes to ego, some examples of taking action: repair a broken relationship, go back to a colleague or a friend and say, I'm sorry, you know what, I messed it up. Let's kind of start again. Let's go back to the drawing board and start our relationship all over again. That helps to kind of come out of the trap of ego. Learn from successful failure. Try to have different approaches at work. It works. So this is how more or less the webinar is: the traps, the conventional approach, and the antidote or the dose or the medicine which you need to have to kind of overcome each of these traps. So busyness, the conventional approach is be a juggler. The idea is to focus and get rid of things which you don't want to do. Procrastination, delay the change, is the conventional approach. The new approach which you're talking in this program is how can you reinvent yourself. Third, the ego: always stay within your comfort zone, don't move out. The antidote or the solution or the realization, the breakthrough moment is, how can you experiment and come out of it? So my friends, well, it's 3:51 and we are doing well with time. We have about 9 minutes to four. I will stop and invite questions from all the participants who are on the call today here. Any questions? No questions? Parag says that Edison actually did not invent the bulb. He was a better businessman. Yes, but he made good amount of money by failing, Sunil Kumar says, very interactive session. Yes, there's another reaction there. What does that say? Okay, Karishma says, be the first one to fail too. Yes, of course. Fail fast. Yes. Fail fast and get up fast. That's the mantra in terms of failure. It's okay, perfectly okay to fail. All right. If there are no questions, I would again request my colleagues to kind of put the overview of the program here, the PDF file, just for the benefit of our participants out here. May 26th, we have a public workshop where we'll be doing the full-blown program, and it will be conducted by my fellow colleague, my senior colleague, George, and myself. We both will be doing it. So if you're interested, since it is the first of its program being rolled out, we are coming up with promotional offers. So please feel free to reach out to any of my colleagues. As you see, it is getting registered in the chat box. Anubhuti and Himani, Harshit, three of my colleagues here who can kind of give you more information, and I would invite you to that. It is worth the time, it's worth the investment. With that, more or less, I am done. George, any closing comments from your side before we say bye to the participants?
Nothing much. On the full course, we will have four more traps, three traps of the team. Very seldom we recognize them. And of course, the company trap, the me, we, and us. At the end of the day, all three will have to synchronize, then only it will be. When you go through this course, you will realize, and you will also find that someone is getting into a trap, you can actually go and warn that person. Look, hey, you're getting into a trap. Better get out of it as quickly as possible. So a trapologist is not only making sure that he's safe, but he'll also make the other person safe. And he'll ensure that he's also with you.
Thanks, George, for that.
Thank you.
All right. So if not, then thank you very much for your time and attention. Sunil, okay, Shyam has raised his hand. Yes, Mr. Shyam, how can I help you? Shyam has raised. Yes, Shyam, go ahead. So I don't know whether Shyam is trying to say something or giving me a high five or giving George a high five.
I think he raised the hand that I mentioned. If anyone wishes, we can have a word with him one to one.
All right, no worries. We can definitely have a word with Mr. Shyam one to one. No problem. You are able to hear me, guys?
Yeah, very clear.
Yes, Samar.
All right. Okay, great. Any other question, any other comments? We'll be here till about 4 o'clock. In case my fellow participants, my clients who have come here, in case you want to log out, please do that. But we will stay here for the next 4 minutes in case we have some questions or any queries coming up our way. Thank you very much for your time and attention. George, again, a big thank you for helping me in this session. And of course, thank you, Himani, Anubhuti, and Ashit to kind of synthesize and being producers for this webinar. Thank you very much, everyone.
Thank you, Amar. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Bye-bye.